Okay, so welcome. Ja, we are proving Wigner semicircle law. And in previous lectures, we did it for a very special ensemble, for the Gaussian unitary ensembles, where we have very precise formulas for calculating expectations of independent Gaussian variables of the entries of our matrix. And now we want to do the same for more general ensembles, namely Wigner matrices, where we still have the independence up to a symmetry of the entries, but the distribution of the entries can be more or less an arbitrary distribution given by some probability distribution mu. And we want to see that also in this case, at least in expectation, the eigenvalue distribution converges to the semicircle. And of course, there we don't have precise formulas for the moment. So this means what we have to do is more arguing that many guys go to zero, even if we don't really know explicitly what they are. We just want to see that they go to zero in a limit, and only what survives are the leading order terms, and they should be the same as in the Gaussian case. So we should also see the Catalan numbers there. Good. So let me recall. So now we are looking on a Wigner matrix. So this is again, let's say, n by n matrix, where we have a scaling, which is as before, 1 over square root of n. And then we have entries aij, ij, running from 1 up to n, where the aij are up to the symmetry condition, independent random variables, and we also assume them to be identically distributed, and the distribution is given by some probability measure mu, which we fix in the beginning. So the aij, at least the ones for, let's say, on or above the diagonal, are identically independent and identically distributed random variables with distribution mu. And of course, the guys below the diagonal are the same as the one above the diagonal, so the aij is the same as aji. And we are dealing here with real-valued random variables, so I don't need a complex conjugate. In the Gaussian case, it was somehow nicer to have a complex situation because then the Wigner formula really takes on the nicest form. But here we don't really have a precise Wigner formula, so it doesn't make a difference whether we take real or complex entries. So we restrict here to the real ones. Good. And I said, I mean, of course, so this is again maybe the nicest situation in this context where we assume guys are identically distributed and we have a distribution mu. And for this mu, of course, we need some assumptions. Of course, we assume that all moments exist because we still want to do a combinatorial approach. We have to calculate traces of power, so we need all moments. The second moment, we normalize to 1, and the first moment, we need to be equal to 0. Okay. And the higher ones shouldn't make somehow a contribution. Okay, if we are going to prove Wigner semicircle law with analytic tools, then actually one can get rid of some of those assumptions. So not all moments have to exist. What one really needs is the first and the second moment. Then Wigner semicircle law is true. And actually, in analytic approach, one doesn't even need that the first moment is equal to 0. Because it gives a shift which disappears somehow in the limit. And you should look on this in the assignments by playing around a little bit with this. Good. And of course, one can also get rid with the identical distribution by maybe having maybe different distributions on the diagonal and the off-diagonal, or maybe just having uniform bounds for the higher moments. Okay, so I mean, there are a lot of generalizations possible, but we stick to the simplest one, so that the proof is as clean as it can be. Okay, so now let us look on what we want to do. So we consider now such a Wigner matrix. So maybe I write it down again. So An is 1 over square root of n, Aij, Anj from 1 up to n. where the distribution is mu, and where we assume that mu has all moments. The first moment is zero, so this means the integral of x d mu x is equal to zero, and the second moment, I mean, we normalize it to one. Okay, of course, the normalization with n, this is already explicitly here. Okay, so those guys have a distribution which does not depend on n. But there is, of course, a dependency on n, which is here. Okay, so nice. Yeah. Best normalization is to say that the second moment of mu, or the variance, which is the same as the variance if the first moment vanishes, is equal to 1. Good, and then, of course, again, we have to calculate. So what we want to see is that the expectation of traces of powers of our matrix converges to the corresponding moment of the semicircle, which is given by the Catalan numbers. So we have to look on the same quantity as before. So namely, we take the expectation of the normalized trace of a power, let's say power m, of our matrix. And we just write it again explicitly, how this depends on the entries of our matrix. Oh, that's the same as in the Gaussian case, of course. That's the same for all matrices. So we get some powers of n. I mean, we get a power square 1 over square root of n for each a. So we have m of them. And then we get a 1 over m n because of the normalization of this normalized trace. So we have 1 over n to the power m over 2 plus 1. Okay, then I write the matrix multiplication and the trace as a summation over many indices. So I need m indices, i1 up to im. Each is running from 1 up to n. And then we get the expectation of the product of the entries in the usual way. So I have ai1, i2, ai2, i3, and so on, up to aim, i1. So I mean, index appearing here being the same and being summed over is the matrix product, and that the first index here is the same as the last here, and I'm summing over this. This is just taking the trace of this guy. Good. Okay, and so now we have to see what we can do. And of course, what we should do is to do at least a partial summation over this. I mean, these sums, they are m indices, and they are all running from 1 up to n. So in principle, we have n to the m terms. And what we did before was doing somehow a kind of partial summation, collecting a lot of terms into classes, which all give the same contribution. Okay, and here we are doing the same. But now we are collecting terms not by a Wick formula according to the position of the a's, but we do it just according to all the indices here. We are just splitting all the indices which show up here into classes such that whether the indices are the same or not. So I'm writing this now as n m over 2 plus 1. And I'm summing now actually over partitions of the indices. Before we summed over pairings of the positions of the factors. Okay, I mean, this is not so useful at this point because we don't have a Wick formula. So what I'm going to do is I'm summing over partitions of all the indices appearing here. So I'm summing over partitions, sigma pm, and I will define in a minute what I really mean with this. And then I'm collecting all the terms which have somehow those sigmas as their kernel. So I'm looking on I as a function from m to n, but where the kernel of I is equal to sigma, and then I get here a contribution which is the same for all I which have the same kernel, and so it's only is a contribution which depends on sigma. Okay, and I of course have to explain what I really mean with this formula. So what we are doing here is we group the indices over which we sum. Those are the indices i1 up to im. according to what I call a kernel, and this kernel is actually a partition which I'm going to denote sigma of 1 up to m. Okay, and this kernel tells me essentially where the indices are the same and where they are different. Good. Okay, so let me first define all this, and then in the end, hopefully, this here will be clear. But I mean, we already talked about pairings and this stuff, so this is very similar. But now we have partitions where the blocks are not only pairs. So here's a definition. So of a partition. So partition sigma of the set 1 up to n. So what is this? This is a decomposition into disjoint non-empty subsets. So this is like for a pairing, but now we don't require that the subsets always have two elements. It can be just an arbitrary number of elements, but otherwise it's as before. So this is a decomposition of the set 1 up to n. Into disjoint and non-empty subsets, but of arbitrary size. In the case of pairing, we had the same, but there we required, in addition, that the subsets all have size 2. Now we allow any size of the subsets. So there can be a block of size 1, there can be a block of size 4, and so they don't need the same size. Okay, so maybe more precisely, this means sigma is a collection of those sets, so it's V1 up to Vk, where I'm just writing in formulas what I said before in words, so each of the Vi's should be a subset of this set 1 up to n. So each Vi is a subset of this set 1 up to n, of course for all the i's. Then they should be non-empty. And they should be disjoint. So if I have two of them, a Vi and a Vj, the intersection should be empty for all I which are different from j. And then, of course, they together should be give a decomposition. So this means their union is just everything. So the union of the Vi's, I running from 1 up to k, I assume I have k of them, this is the whole set n. Just to recall, this is our notation for the set 1, 2, up to n. Good, okay, so partition is such a collection, and as before, we are calling those Vi's the blocks. Like in the case of pairings, those guys are the blocks of sigma. Vi are called blocks of sigma. It's good to have a notation for all partitions of a given set. And we denote it as before with a p of n. Before we had the p with a subscript 2, which indicated that we only allow pairings. But now we allow all sizes, and we just denote it by p of n. So the set of all partitions of this set 1 up to n is denoted by P of n. And so this is by definition the collection of all sigmas such that sigma is a partition of the set 1 up to n. Okay, and of course it doesn't really matter, I mean, how we denote the elements in this set. It's just a partition of a set of n elements. Good, okay. But so now we are using those partitions for describing us the kernel of multi-indices. Because what we are summing here is we are summing over multi-indices. So we are summing over a tuple of m indices. which we also can consider as a function from a set 1 m up to n, and the kernel gives us the information where the indices are the same and where they are different. And this information is encoded exactly in a partition. So that's part two of the definition. So what is a kernel of a multi-index? So for a multi-index I, so this is just a tuple of m indices, i1 up to im. We denote its kernel, or we denote by kernel of I, its kernel. Okay, and this is by definition a partition of M. I have here M indices, so this is by definition the partition sigma. Let me say I have here n indices. So just because I had n before. So it's n indices. So it's a partition of the numbers 1 up to n. And it is defined in a way such that we have that ik, it tells me whether two indices are the same or not. So ik is equal to il if and only if k and l are in the same block of my partition. So k and l are in the same block of this partition sigma, of this kernel. So this is if and only if. So this really means each block of my kernel corresponds to the positions of the indices which take on the same value, for some value. And for each block, I have a different value. And of course, what we usually do is we identify such a multi-index with a function from m to n. So if we identify I with the function I from the set 1 up to n to the set, let's say, our indices are taking on values in the set 1 to capital N. And of course, this identification is just, that I of k is just I sub k. So index is just a function. And then we can also write that the blocks of our partition are just the pre-images of the different values which I'm taking on. So then we can also write that the kernel of I consists just of the pre-images I minus 1 of the value 1. So it's just where does my indices take on the value 1, I minus 1 of 2, where do they take on the value 2, and so on, I to the minus 1 of n. And of course here, I have several empty blocks, because there might be numbers which are not taken on as indices, in particular if the capital N is much larger as the little n, which usually it is in our setting, then of course many numbers are not taken on. And then I have a lot of empty sets here, but I just discard them. So the blocks of my partition are just the non-empty pre-images which I have here. So where we discard all empty sets. Good. Maybe I'm making an example just to make this clear. good. Okay, so let's say my multi-index I, so it has it's a seven tuple consisting of, let's say, 1, 2, 1, 3, 2, 4, 3. So this is my tuple. This is I1, I2, I3, I4, I5, I6, I7. For this, yeah, we have what is its kernel? So what is the kernel of I? So I have here seven numbers, and I have here the 1, 2, 1, 3, 2, 4, 3. And those numbers are actually the images of my function, the function which goes from 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Okay, so those points, I mean 1, 2, up to 7, gives me the positions which I have here, and at those positions I have the I indices, I1, I2, and so on. Okay, now the partition which I have is a partition of the positions 1 up to 7, which tells me at which positions I have the same index. So for example, this one here appears here and here, so this is one block. Then the 4, for example, only appears here. 3 appears here and here, and 2 appears here and here. So that would be my partition. Okay, now it has 3 blocks of size 2 and 1 block of size 1. Maybe let me change it. Maybe let me also put a 2 here. Then I would also have a block of size 3. So I put a 2 here. Then I have here a block of size 3. I have here a block of size 2, here a block of size 1, a block of size 1, and here a block of size 3, corresponding to the 2, which appears 3 times. Okay, so this is a this is a partition of 1 up to 7. So this means I'm writing, is a collection of the blocks, which I'm writing as 1, 3, 2, 5, 7, 4, and 6. And this is a partition of 7 elements, those 7 positions here. Okay, so that's what we mean with a partition, and in particular, partitions in our context are arising very canonically as the information about our multi-indices. Because what we really care about the multi-indices, when we are looking on sums like this, is where are the multi-indices where are the same and where are they different. Because I have two multi-indices, which at the same positions are the same, then actually this quantity here depends only on those positions, not on the actual value of the multi-index. So that's the main important property for us. And so I put this into the next remark, that if we have two multi-indices which have the same kernel, then their contribution in our sum is actually the same. So the contribution doesn't depend on the actual value of the multi-index, but it only depends on its kernel. And this gives us again the possibility of decomposing this sum here, which increases with n, into classes which are counted by the partitions of m. And those classes don't increase with n. Yeah, so here is this remark. So the relevance of this kernel of a multi-index in our setting is the following. So namely, if we have a multi-index, let's say I, so we have I1 up to IM, okay, let's now say M as we have it here, and we have another multi-index, let's say J, which is J1 up to JM, and the kernels of those two guys are the same, so such that the kernel of I is the same as the kernel of J, so both are partitions of the set 1 up to M, then this implies that the expectation, which we have here in our calculation of the moments of the term corresponding to I, so this is A I1, I2 up to A I m I1, that this is the same as the expectation of the corresponding quantities in a J, so A J1, J2 up to A J m J1. And this relies on the fact that we have variables which are independent and identically distributed. Identically distributed means in the end it doesn't matter which of the guys I take, they all have the same distribution. But one has, of course, to see, I'm talking here about whether the I's are the same or not, but for the variables, I have to compare variables which have two indices. So talking whether they are the same or not, I have to look on the pairs of indices. So this is somehow the transition which I have to make, but at least we have this implication. So maybe let us do an example just to make this clear. So for example, let me take I, so an index of so 1, 1, 2, 1, 1, 2, so an index of 6, a 6 tuple, and also j, this also a 6 tuple, but now we have 2, 2, 7, 2, 2, 7. So what are the kernels? So the kernels, they are telling me where the index is the same. I mean here this 2 appears here, and then I have 4 times the 1 appearing at those positions. Here I have the 7, which appears here, and I have the 2 appearing 4 times. But the 2 appears here exactly at the same positions where the 1 appears here, and the 7 appears here at the same positions as the 2. So those two guys have the same kernel. They consist of different indices, but the pattern where the indices are the same and where they are different, that's equal for both of them. So we have, so for those guys, we have that their kernel is the same. Kernel of I and the kernel of J is the same, and it's this picture here. Okay, and so this for us has the consequence that if I'm calculating this corresponding quantity here, the expectation of a product of entries of my matrices, which are indexed by the i's or by the j's, that this is the same. So maybe let me write it down, what it is in both cases, and see why it is the same. So what I have to calculate, so I mean I have to look on this expectation of the product of the A's. And so, what is this? So for the I, so this is the expectation. And so now I have A sub I1, I2, but this is 1 and 1. Then I have 1 and 2, 2 and 1, A 1, 1. A 1, 2, and A 2, 1. So the I 1 is 1, the I 2 is 1, the I 3 is 2, the I 4 is 1, and so on. Okay. And the other quantity, so for the J, I have the quantity where the I 1 is 2, so I have here A 2, and the I 2 is also 2, so it's A 2, 2. A 2 7, A 7 2, A 2 2, A 2 7, A 7 2. And so now, of course, I have different A's appearing here and different A's appearing here, but if I want to calculate this expectation, I mean, I have to see I have a product of independent A's. And of course, it factorizes according to the products. So what I have to take here is the A11 A11, so this appears here and here, and of course in the same way, the A22 and the A22 appears here. Because, if I replace all the I's by the J's, and this was the same as this, then it is here the same, and of course this A22 appears exactly at the same positions as appeared the guy here. So this means this guy here is factorizing, and then of course, what are the other quantities? I have the A12, and of course, the A12 can also appear as the A21. That's also something which I have to take care of. Because of the symmetry, this A21 is actually the same as the A12, so all those guys are the same, but of course, they also appear here in exactly the same way. So again, it's the same quantity here, so the 1-2 is replaced by the 2-7. And correspondingly, the mirror image also appears at the same place, because the 2-1 is then also replaced by the 7-2. So this means I have here the variable A11 twice, and the variable A12 four times, and in the same way, I have here the A22 twice, and the A27 four times. And because I have here an independent variable, it factorizes. So here it factorizes into the expectation of A11 squared times the expectation of A12 to the power 4, and here correspondingly, it factorizes into the expectation of A22 squared times the expectation of A27 to the power 4. But now we have assumed that all the entries have the same distribution. So this means the A22 has the same distribution as the A11, and this means the second moment of this guy is the same as the second moment of this guy. The A27 has the same distribution as the A12, which means the fourth moment of this is the same as the fourth moment of this. So actually, those quantities are the same, which means this here is also the same. And this is true in general. So if I have two indices whose kernel is the same, then this expression is also the same. And so this expression here, this guy here, does not really depend on the actual value of the indices here, but it only depends on the kernel. So this means I'm going to call this quantity here, which is the same for both, I call this expectation of the kernel. It only depends on the kernel. So maybe let me write this again. So we denote this common value by E of sigma, if sigma is the kernel. E sigma, so this is E of any product of the expectation of AI1, I2, AIM, I1, for which the kernel of the I's is the sigma, if the kernel of I is equal to sigma. Because we saw it only depends on the kernel. So I can take here any multi-index I, which has the kernel sigma, and I get here the same value, and so I denote this by this. Yeah, but then this means I get this formula, which I essentially have written down here. So I can now do the summation over all the indices by collecting the indices into classes which have the same kernel. And the kernel is a partition of M, and any partition can show up there. So I'm summing over the partitions, and then I'm summing over the indices which have this partition as their kernel. Good, okay, but the actual value contribution now depends not on the I anymore, but only on the kernel, and so this sum just means I have to count how many indices do I have which have this sigma as its kernel. And this is again something which is quite easy to count. Because if I have a partition and I want to know how many multi-indices do I have, let's say multi-indices which take on the values between 1 and n, do I have which have this as a kernel? Yeah, but this is very easy. Because if I have Yeah, for example, if I have this situation here where my kernel is, yeah, what is it? I have yeah, I just erased it. So the kernel was 1, 2, 3. Yeah, so maybe the I indices was 1, 2. So I mean the indices appearing, this is I1, this is I2. Yeah, okay. This is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So okay, so I have 1, 1, 2, 1, 1, 2. This was my the I tuple, and so I have this as the kernel. And so now if I want to know how many indices do I find which have this as its kernel, then of course what can I do? I mean, I know that on, let's say, the first block of my partition, I can choose any number between 1 and n. But then this number must appear at those four places. Okay, and then I take the next block, and there I can put a number which must be different from the number on the first block, but otherwise it can be arbitrary. So there I have n minus 1 possibilities. Okay, then if I have a third block, I can choose there any number which is different from the two numbers which I have already chosen. So I have n minus 2 possibilities for this. Good. And of course, if n is large, then this is more or less on each block I can choose n possibilities. The condition that it have to be different is for n large doesn't really count. Good, but so let me write this down. So what we get, so in our calculation, the expectation of the trace of an to the power m, this is 1 over our n to the power 1 plus m over 2. And then I have the sum over all possible partitions of the positions 1 up to m. Okay, and I get for all indices which have those guys as its kernel, I get the same contribution. So I get the contribution E of sigma. And the sum over the i's now just means I have to count how many i's do I have. So I have to multiply this with the number of I multi-indices from m to n which have the sigma as its kernel. Yeah. And yeah, good. This is easy to count. So this guy here is, of course, so this is n times n minus 1 and so on up to n minus the number of blocks in sigma plus 1. So asymptotically, this behaves to like n to the number of blocks in sigma. Okay, good. And so this gives again a formula where we have to sum, now not over pairings, but over partitions. And for each partition, we get a contribution which goes with n to the number of its blocks. And then we have here other n factors. And now we have to see what is the leading order term. But of course, we also get a contribution from here, essentially, which tells us whether we get something or not. Okay, so what we have to see is what are actually the leading orders here in this contribution. As before, not all sigma will survive in a limit, but some of them will be suppressed. And of course, what survives should be something which is again counted by the Catalan numbers. Okay, but I mean in this case, I mean in the case of pairings, it was the non-crossing pairings which survived. In this case here, the non-crossing thing is not really the exact the good thing to understand this, and really to understand the contribution which we are getting here, it's the best is to associate to such a sigma a graph, and then understand things in terms of this graph. So to understand contribution which corresponds to such a sigma corresponding to a sigma which is a partition of M, we associate to sigma actually a graph which I call G sigma. So this depends on sigma, and it will contain in a good way the information which we need for understanding the asymptotics in this behavior here. So if you just look on this, of course, you can say, of course, the leading order here is the one where sigma has as many blocks as possible, but this would mean that all indices are different. But in such a case, this guy will be zero, because of our assumption of independence and first means zero. So there will be some constraints coming from here, which tells me that not too many indices can be different. We have to balance this somehow. But it's hard to see this directly here, so it's good to go over to this graph and encode this information, because there we can read off this more nicely. So I give you now the definition of this graph. So for a given partition of M elements, I associate a graph. And essentially, this graph contains the information about which indices are the same. But what we also need is, you see that here we have somehow indices showing the indices of the A's, of the variables for which we really calculate the moments, are always pairs of the indices which we have. And so the pairs consisting of consecutive guys, so I have here I1, I2, I have here I2, I3, and so on. And this information is also important to understand this contribution. So in my graph, I should not only see the I's, where they are the same and where they are different, but I should also somehow see the information that actually I1 and I2 should be neighbors. I2 and I3 should be neighbors. And of course, a graph is a good way of encoding neighbors, because, I mean, I have vertices which corresponds to the eyes, and I have edges, which tells me that those guys should be neighbors. So my graph is here. So I start from a partition. So sigma, let me denoted by V1 up to Vk, so those are the blocks of this partition. So this is a partition of numbers 1 up to M. So for such a thing, we define a corresponding graph and I call this G sigma, as a graph which depends on sigma, and I define it as follows. For a graph, I mean, a graph consists of vertices and edges, so I should tell you what are the vertices and what are the edges of this graph. And the vertices of this graph are nothing else than the blocks of this guy. So this is really information which indices are the same. So the vertices of G sigma are given by the blocks VP, all the blocks of sigma. So each block of sigma is a vertex of my graph. But then I want more information, not just information about where the indices are the same and where they are not the same, but also the information that actually I1 and I2 should be neighbors, and I2 and I3 should be neighbors. But those were neighbors from the very beginning, but now I have identified some indices. So this means I should now have a property of being neighbors for the blocks. And this means, of course, that the blocks corresponds to indices. So two blocks are now neighbors if they contain indices which were neighbors from the very beginning. Maybe I should write it down. So and there is an edge. Okay, so I have told you what are the vertices, and now I'm telling you what are the edges. And so there is an edge between VP, between two blocks, and VQ, if there is an R in the set 1 up to M, such that this R is in my block VP, in one of the blocks, and the R plus 1 is in VQ. And of course, this plus 1, I'm always counting mod M. Good. Okay, maybe a better way of saying this is that, I just start from this situation where I have M indices and I declare I1 to be a neighbor of I2, I2 to be a neighbor of I3, and so on. So I have a cycle, and then I identify just some of the neighbors according to pi, and then I get a new graph. And that's what I'm doing here. So maybe that's a clearer way. So another way of saying this is that we start with a graph which has m vertices, namely 1 up to m, corresponding to the indices i1 up to ym. And this has edges, which tells me that i1 is a neighbor of i2, and i2 is a neighbor of i3, and so on. So the edges are 1, 2, 2, 3, 3, 4, and so on, up to m minus 1, m, and then m and 1. So this is just a cycle. So this is just a graph that I have 1, 2, 3, and so on, up to m minus 1 and m. And I have 1 is connected to 2, 2 is connected to 3, and so on. And I get here just a cycle. M minus 1 is connected to m, and m is connected to 1. So this is my starting graph. And now in this graph, I'm identifying some of the vertices according to my partition. My partition tells me exactly that the elements which are in a block should be identified. And then I get this graph G of sigma, which contains all the information which I need to understand for the sigma, but also information which I need to understand this guy here. Okay, so this graph is, we get this graph by starting with this graph of the vertices 1 up to m, and putting edges in a cyclic way, and then identify vertices according to the blocks of sigma. Okay, and in these blocks, of course, we have then the edges which we had before, which were just different edges. I mean, after this identification, some of them might become loops, and we might also get multiple edges. And the loops we keep, but the multiple edges we just throw away. They are not so important. So we keep loops, but erase multiple edges. Good, so let me do a few examples, huh, just to make this clear that we really understand what I'm doing here. So let's say I have sigma, I take a partition of 5 elements of the form 1 and 3 is a block, 4 is a block by itself, and 2 and 5 is a block. So this guy has 3 blocks. As a partition, I would write it as 1, 3 is a block, 2, 5 is a block, and 4 is a block. Good. Okay, now the blocks become the vertices in my graph. So I have now 3 vertices. I mean, one vertex corresponds to 1 and 3 being identified. One vertex corresponds to 4, and one vertex corresponds to 2 and 5 being identified. Okay, so those are my 3 vertices corresponding to the blocks. And now I just draw in this graph the connection which I had before. I mean, 1 was connected to 2, 2 to 3, and so on. So 1 is connected to 2, which means I get a connection here. Then 2 is connected to 3, so this would give me another connection, but it's already connected, so I don't care about this. Then 3 is connected to 4, which means I'm connecting this. 4 is connected to 5, and 5 is connected to 1. Okay, so this is the graph for this guy. Okay, maybe another example. Let's say I take sigma, I take as 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, again 5. 3 is a block, 2 and 4 is a block, and 1 and 5 is a block. So this is the partition 1, 5, 2, 4, and 3. So it has as a block structure, it's the same as before. It has a block of size 1 and it has 2 blocks of size 2. But I mean the corresponding graph is now, so this gives a graph which looks a little bit different than this. So here I have 1 and 5 is one block, 2 and 4 is one block, and 3. Is a block by itself. So those are the 3 vertices of my graph. And now I just draw the connections in the cyclic way. So 1 is connected to 2, 2 is connected to 3, 3 is connected to 4, but we already have this, 4 is connected to 5, we already have this, and 5 is connected to 1, so we get also a loop here. So you see we have this graph here. And maybe still another one, which maybe is the nicest one, which is really the one which have the features which are surviving in the end. So namely, let me take, let's say, a partition of 4 elements, which has this form. So I have a block of size 2, connecting 1 and 3, and I have a block of size 1, which consists of 2, and a block of size 1, which consists of 4. So this gives me G sigma. So 1 and 3 is a block, and 2 and 4 are blocks by themselves. Okay, and what are the edges now? 1 is connected to 2, 2 is connected to 3, okay, we have this, 3 is connected to 4, 4 is connected to 1, but we already have this. So you see, we get something like this. And I mean, this is actually a tree, Okay, I mean, this is not a tree; it has cycles, and this has loops. So this is also not so good. But this is a tree, and we will see that actually guys like this will survive in the end. Good. But for seeing this, I mean, what we have to understand is not just how many blocks do I have? I mean, this gives me this power here. But I also have to understand whether I get a contribution from here. Because this guy here sometimes is 0, and so we have to understand when is this different from 0. And for this, it's good that also this term we somehow can understand in this picture. So the term which we really have to understand, namely a I1, I2, a I2, I3, a I m, I1. So what is this? This corresponds actually to a walk in this graph. So this corresponds to a walk in the graph G sigma, of course, where sigma is the kernel of my indices here. And so what is the walk? I'm walking along the edges, because you see, I have here the variable I1, I2, and this corresponds of walking from I1 to I2. So walking along this edge. So actually, I mean, the vertices here correspond to my indices, I1 and I2 and so on. But the variables which I have, they are actually indexed by a pair of indices, and they correspond in this picture to the edges. Because, I mean, I always have an index pair where I1 and I2 is a pair, I2 and I3 is a pair, and those are exactly the edges as I have chosen them here. So I have connected the guys which correspond to neighboring indices. Okay, so this means this thing here is really a walk in my graph. And the contribution for A, I1, I2 is really, so the A, I1, I2 is sitting at the edges. Okay, so this is a walk in a graph along the edges. And the steps, of course, are that I'm going from I1 to I2, from I2 to I3, and so on, up to Im minus 1, going to Im, and then going back to I1. And now, of course, you should think that this is I1 is equal to I3, this is I2, and this is I4. Good, and this means that in my walk, we are using each edge in this graph exactly once. Because, you know, I mean this graph was coming from the we started really with the identification, let's say the indices, maybe let me put here I1, I2, I3, I4, up to Im, and then I had the edges where I just went here around. And this is just exactly the product of AI1, I2 times AI2, I3, and so on. And this means in this graph, I'm using each edge exactly once. If I now do the identification of some of the vertices, I get my quotient graph here, where these edges here are still coming from the edges here. And if in my walk, each edge was used once, I mean, all the edges which I have here must be used at least once. But because there are now some identifications, so I might use them in this picture more often. I mean, this edge here corresponds in this here to the edge 1, 2, but also to the edge 2, 3. But at least, I mean, each edge appears at least once. Hence, we are using each edge in G sigma at least once. Okay, and now we should note that the different edges which I have in this graph, or maybe in this graph, they really correspond to independent random variables. So I mean, this edge here corresponds to A14, and this corresponds to 32, but the indices are the same. So the point here is, I mean, I have identified here the edges which corresponds to the same A variables. And of course, I have to see that Aij and Aji are the same, but I mean, this just means that I'm just forgetting the direction of the edge. I could go from I to J, or I could go from J to I. So it's the same edge, but just going the other direction. Okay, but after this identification, all the edges which I have here in this graph G sigma correspond to different variables in my random matrix, different up to the symmetry, and so this means all of them are independent variables. So this means in my walk, if I'm walking around, if I'm using one of the edge only once, then this A variable appears only once. But then this means that this gives a contribution zero, because this A variable is then independent of all the other ones. I have a factorization, and I get the expectation of this variable, but my variables are centered, so this I get a contribution zero. This tells me that in my walk, I must use each edge at least twice in order to get a non-zero contribution here. Good, okay, so that's the crucial observation here. So I mean, this graph really contains the information which I need for understanding my sum. So note that different edges in G sigma correspond to independent random variables, and this means in particular, if in our walk we use an edge only once, so if we use an edge only once in our walk, then the corresponding contribution corresponding to this sigma is zero, because this expectation, I mean, this is an expectation of a product of A's, and this expectation of course factorizes into the product of the expectations of the independent variables which appear there, but if you use an edge only once, I mean, there's one variable which appears only once here. So because this expectation factorizes into a product, so one variable is there only once, so we have at least one factor, which is a first moment, being a first moment of one of the variables. Being a first moment of one of the variables aij. Okay, but our assumption was that the first moment of our distribution of the variables is zero. So we assumed the variables to be centered. So this is by assumption to be zero. I told you that actually this assumption that the first moment is zero is not really needed in analytic approach. One can get away with this, but you see, in this combinatorial approach, we really need this. Without this argument, we couldn't really see what happens there. Good, but so we assume the first moment is zero, and this tells us then that if we want here contribution in our sum, then we should only look for sigmas where in the corresponding walk each edge appears at least twice. Because, okay, if it only appears once, then it's zero. So this means each edge should appear at least twice. So thus, every edge must be used at least twice. Good, okay, but this gives us, of course, then somehow an estimate for the number of edges which we can have in our G sigma. So twice this implies that the number of edges in G sigma must be less than, of course, the number of steps in the walk divided by 2. Huh? So we know we have to, use every edge, we must use it at least once. Okay, but now we have seen we must use it at least twice. So this means the number of edges which we have in our graph is less than the number of steps in the walk divided by 2. But the number of steps in the walk, this is just m. Because, I mean, it's always I1 up to I2 up to im up to I1. So the number of steps, so our walks really consists of m steps. So this here is m over 2. Good, now maybe we can go back to this, what we have here. So because now we have a restriction on the sigma over which we sum here. So namely, we know that we only have to sum over sigma such that the number of edges in G sigma is at most m over 2. So maybe I go back to this, and so we already saw that we can count this number of guys which have a given sigma. Yeah, so we have this. And so we get finally, so that the expectation of the normalized trace of the mth power of our matrix, so this is 1 over n divided by n to the power 1 plus m over 2. This comes from our normalizations. Then I'm summing over sigma in the pairings. I get a contribution e sigma, and this is multiplied with the number of multi-indices which have this sigma as its kernel. But we already saw that this is easy to count, because on each block I can put on the first block the n possibilities, on the second block n minus 1, and so on, up to the last block n minus number of sigma plus 1. But of course we are only interested asymptotically, so this asymptotically behaves like n to the number of blocks. So asymptotically I can put on each block, I have n possibilities. That on each block it should be different, asymptotically it doesn't play a role. So, for n going to infinity, good, but if I would sum over all sigma, then I would take here singletons, and then I would have here n to the m, because I mean the number of blocks can be m, if each block is a singleton. Then I would have n to the m, which of course is too big compared to this. Okay, but we saw that there are sigmas which make a doesn't make a contribution, and in order to make a contribution in the walk we must use every edge at least twice, which told us that at least that we cannot have too many edges in this graph. So the number of edges in this graph has to be less than m over 2. Good, but of course this is the number of edges. This number of cycles is the number of vertices. So here we know for this we need to know something about the number of the vertices. Here we have a constraint on the number of edges. And we have to see how is this compared, and what if I have so many edges, what is the best possible way for the number of vertices? And of course, this is a basic graph theoretic result, that if I have a connected graph, which I have here, because I start from a connected and I take a quotient of this, so it's still connected, then there's a I need at least a specific so many edges to connect the graph. And of course, there is the best way to use the smallest number of edges to connect the graph is if I have a tree. So that's what I really need here. Good. Okay. So we have to understand. What the constraint on the number of edges, the constraint on the number of edges, so this constraint here on the number of edges in G sigma gives us for the number of vertices. Vertices in G sigma, and which is of course the same as the number of blocks of sigma, because the vertices of G sigma are the blocks of sigma. This is what I need here. Okay, but here I have a constraint on the number of edges, and for this, one should use this result about graphs, which I recall, which hopefully everybody has seen. If not, you should maybe try to prove it for yourself. This is a basic result in graph theory. Just makes it precise that if you have a number of vertices and you want to connect all of them, you need at least a specific number of edges. You need at least so many edges. And if this minimal number of edges is achieved for a tree, if you don't have cycles, because if you have cycles, then you have put too many connections, which you can just leave out some of them. Good. Okay. So maybe here's this result from graph theory, basic result. So assume we have a graph G. Graph consists of vertices and edges, and we assume it's a connected. So be a connected, of course, finite graph. So we have finite number of vertices and edges, and so V, of course, denotes the vertices. So V is the set of vertices, and E is the set of edges. So this is just a graph, no direction on the edges. And we can allow here loops and multi-edges. So we allow loops and multi-edges. But of course, it is clear for the question, what is the minimum of edges I need to connect such a guy, of course the first thing I would erase are loops and multi-edges. So they don't help much for connecting things. Good, okay, so and then we have always that, let's say the other way around, that if I only have so many edges, there's a number of vertices which I can connect, but not more. So namely, the number of vertices which I can connect with a given number of edges is less or equal to the number of edges plus one. Good. And the special situation where I have equality here, where I just do the connection but nothing more, of course should be the case where I don't have loops, and that's what it is. Namely, this is exactly the case if G is a tree. And we have equality if and only if G is a tree. And a tree is by definition a graph, a connected graph without cycles, where I cannot run round in a cycle. So this means connected graph without cycles. Yeah, but if we have this, then actually we get now our Wigner's theorem. So we have now put everything together. So we can now take somehow the limit of this and understand exactly what is the leading order contribution. So maybe I write now down Wigner's theorem and do the rest of the proof by putting everything together, what we have got now. Yeah, here is so the main theorem, which in this section. So this is now a Wigner semicircle theorem, but for Wigner matrices. So Wigner's semicircle law for Wigner matrices, but still in the averaged form, averaged version. Yeah, so let me write down all the assumptions. So AN should be a Wigner matrix corresponding to a measure mu. So mu is the distribution of the entries. We assume all of them have the same. And of course, we assume that this mu has all moments, which has all moments. We assume that the mean is zero. We saw that this is a crucial thing in our argumentation. So which means zero, and second moment should be one. Good, and then the statement is, then we have that the eigenvalue, the averaged eigenvalue distribution of this converges to the semicircle law. And we are showing this by proving that the moments converge. So then we have, for all m in n, that the limit n going to infinity of the expectation of the normalized trace of a n to the power m is actually the corresponding moment of the semicircle. So 1 over 2 pi, and the semicircle lives from minus 2 to plus 2, so we take the m's moment, and the density is 4 minus x squared divided by 2 pi, and we are integrating over this. The same statement as for the in the Gaussian case, of course the same statement, but the assumptions are of course weaker now. Yeah, and the proof, I mean we have already done the main calculation, so we have seen what we get for this average trace for finite n. So yeah. So from the above, so we get, we should take the limit of course of this. So we get the limit n going to infinity of the expectation normalized trace of a n to the power m. So what is this? So we are summing over all sigma in pm, and we know that we can restrict to this, but maybe let me first write it down with this. So I have e sigma and then I should take the limit n going to infinity, and here I collect all the powers of n which I have. So I have n to the number of blocks of sigma, but I also have these normalization factors in n. So minus m over 2 and minus 1 from the normalized trace. Yeah. And of course, so we have to control this. In particular, we have to see that this doesn't explode. Or maybe if it explodes, that this term is zero then. But we know enough about this. So what we have seen before. So if we want, in order to have that this expectation is different from zero, we know that we have to use each edge in the graph at least twice. We can restrict, and this means we can restrict to sigma, where we have that the number of edges in my graph is less than m over 2. But now, with this here, this implies by 3.8 that actually that the number of vertices in my graph, must be less than the number of edges plus 1. It's less than the number of edges of g sigma plus 1. But for this, we have an estimate. So this is less than m over 2. So what I have here is less than m over 2 plus 1. And now you see that this matches the leading order here. Because this here, of course, is the same as the number of blocks. So you see the, if you restrict to the ones which have a non-zero distribution here, the highest order which we can get here is actually zero. So it doesn't explode. And it only remains to see when do we have the leading order. But of course, the leading order is if this is equal to zero, but which means we need equality here, which means we also need equality here. Which means this is exactly the situation where we have a tree. Okay, so hence, all terms converge, and the only contribution in the limit n to infinity comes from those sigma where we have equality. But this means that what we have is that the number of vertices of in my graph G sigma is equal to the number of edges in G sigma plus 1, which is m over 2 plus 1. So we really need this guy to be equal to this guy, which means we need to have equality here. So in particular here, but this is exactly according to this, telling us that we have a tree. So hence this g sigma must be a tree. Must be a tree, and in our walk we use, then if it is a tree, this for the walk tells us that actually we have to use every edge exactly twice. Before we saw, okay, at least twice, but now we have the extreme situation, so we have to use it exactly twice. And of course, for a tree, this means we have to use it once in one direction and the other times in the other direction. We use it twice, and this means in our product, we have each term appearing exactly two times, so it factorizes into the expectation of second moments. But the second moment was normalized to 1, so for those trees, actually the contribution, this guy here, is 1. So now we use each edge exactly twice, and then must be in opposite direction, but maybe this is not even so important now. So for such a sigma, we have that the expectation of the product corresponding to this is equal to 1, and thus, so what we are getting here is now just counting exactly the guys for which G sigma is a tree. So thus we have this limit n to infinity of the expectation of trace of a n to the power m is actually given by counting. Here we get the leading order, which means we get guys where G sigma is a tree, and then they make a contribution 1. So actually, we are just counting the sigmas for which this is the case. Sigma permutations of m elements such that G sigma is a tree. Okay, and then actually, it's one of the exercises which came out a few days ago, but for which you still have a week, is to count that this is also to see that this is counted by the Catalan numbers. So we will check in exercise that later number is also counted by Catalan numbers. Good. Okay, but maybe I want to make a remark to this, because maybe it might not be so clear. You should note that what we are counting here, this G sigma, is given not just as an abstract tree. So it's not really, what you should count here is not just trees of a number of points, but actually, I mean, we have also the walks in our tree, and a walk has a starting point, so this means the trees have a root, a specified point where we start our walk. So this means we are counting rooted trees, actually, and then actually what we also have is somehow a cyclic order in our tree, because we have the walk, which gives us an order, and this means in particular if we are coming to a vertex and we have several outgoing edges, then we have an ordering of them because the walk gives us a special order. Also, what we have is also a tree where at each edge, the outgoing edges have a cyclic order. And this means we can draw in the plane the tree according to this order, so what we really have are planar trees. Where we also have a planar embedding them. So what really we need here, we have to count our rooted planar trees. They really correspond to what we have there. Maybe I do quick a few examples, but that's what you should do in the exercise to think a little bit more about this. So for example, for m equal to 2, okay, there's one tree. We have two vertices and there's one tree, and we have this as a root corresponding to the to the first Catalan number. For m equal to 4, so we have a tree of three elements, of three points, and actually as a tree there's only one, but as a rooted tree there are two, this guy here is different from this guy. As trees they are the same, but the rooted means I have specified one point as a special point, and this is different from this. So there are two possibilities corresponding to the fact that the fourth moment is equal to 2. For m equal to 6, there should be 5 possibilities. So these are planar rooted trees of 4 points. And of course, so what do we have? You can always think that you are hanging it down from the root. So actually, it's a root, but the opposite way. Maybe I should put the root there, but anyhow. So usually you put, often you put the root on the top. So this one here, and then I have this one, I have this one, and then I have two more possibilities, which go like this. So those are the five possibilities. And you see, I mean, those guys, as rooted trees, they would be the same, but here I distinguish them because I draw them in a planar way. So this means I have to distinguish them because, I mean, I'm drawing them in order, so I mean, I can say I have here, this is the left child and this is the right child, or the other way around. And I mean, this guy has two offsprings, whereas here, here the second child has two offspring, here the first one. So this is really distinguished as planar trees. But this really corresponds to our walk. So if I have such guys, then the walk is really just walking around here, I mean, just walking around this in a canonical way. And essentially, the walk tells me that I should draw it in this way. So here I'm walking in this way. So whenever I come to a vertex, I take the rightmost or the leftmost direction which I have not already taken. So that's what you really should think a little bit about in this exercise and see that those are the guys which we really want to count here. Because I mean that's the guys which are showing up here, because there is always this walk coming with them. And then I mean, of course, you should see somehow that there are of those guys, there are Catalan many. But one way of seeing this is, for example, to make a bijection between those guys and non-crossing pairings, for example. Of course, one can also try to see the recursion for the Catalan numbers more directly. But anyhow, so I think that's enough for this. And then next time we will start to look more on the analytic description and also analytic proof of Wigner semicircle. Thank you.